Saturday Mailbag. We are back in the U.S.
Yes.
I feel like I've kind of fully recovered. I don't know about this guy, though.
Well, the funny thing is, as you say, we're back in the U.S., I'll give you guys a little secret. When you're watching this thing, I'm going to be on an airplane somewhere over the Pacific Ocean heading to Taiwan. So I will be not in the U.S.
As much as I love traveling, I will say that after the, what was it, 14 hours total we were in the air for Israel,
yes.
I do not envy you for getting back on a crazy long flight.
Yeah, and I give a shout out to all the Israel fans that
yes.
we met up at the meetup. That was a lot of fun. It was cool seeing that, you know, we have an international fan base.
Mm-hmm. It was easily one of my favorite parts of the trip, and we were talking about it as we were planning it. We didn't think that many people were gonna come, and then all of a sudden the night came and there were a solid 20 people
yeah.
there, and it was so nice to get to sit down and talk to everybody so intimately, and then the idea of all of you guys in Israel meeting each other, that mm-hmm. made it really something special. So I will echo that and say thank you very much to everybody who came out for that meetup. And right now, we've got 5 mailbag questions. This is our Saturday edition of the show where we take your viewer-submitted questions. They come from all over the place right now. You could send it via email at mailbag@collider.com. I was about to say the old one.
Yes.
Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. You could hit us up any way you want, and your question might be answered on this show. Today's first question comes from Matt, who sent his question in via Twitter. Matt asks, what is your favorite song or songs that come from a movie soundtrack? Mine are The Power of Love, On the Dark Side, Drive It Like You Stole It, and God Gave Rock and Roll to You Too.
Okay, so for me, if it was when I was a kid, it'd be You Got the Touch from the Transformers 1985 movie.
Don't ever tell Roka that.
But as I grew older, I think two songs that really stick out to me is Bruce Springsteen's The Wrestler that plays at the end credits of The Wrestler. And then also Eminem's Lose Yourself for 8 Mile. I think those two are my favorite songs that actually come from movies.
Okay.
Not just like, you know, how like they make a song and then like they kind of like just bring it in and make it feel like it's part of the movie, but really it was recorded or created separate from the movie.
Okay. So right now when I run, you know, I run a lot and I like to listen to some of my favorite songs. Still in the rotation from the end of last year, I have Mystery of Love from Call Me By Your Name. I still have, actually not Drive It Like You Stole It, but Girls. Girls is the one song that has stayed on my running playlist since the year before. What else do I have? I still have Greatest Showman on there a little bit.
Another thing, you and Roka.
Another thing that I'm not going to tell Roka. I hope he doesn't watch this. But in general, over the course of my life, mm-hmm. I would say one of the most influential soundtracks ever for me was Empire Records, because mm-hmm. it was the movie and the soundtrack that introduced me to the Gin Blossoms. And I mean, I'm still a little in this phase of my life where I'm a little young, I guess, to be a fan of the Gin Blossoms, and I used to, in Manhattan at least, go to their concert at B.B. King's mm-hmm. every single year, and I was always the youngest person there by like 20 years, and I still actually, in my wallet, in my little change purse, I carry around a Gin Blossoms guitar pick that I caught.
That's fine. Gin Blossoms, I listened to them when I was in high school, so you were probably like elementary school or something.
I watched Empire Records when I was really, 95? I was really little.
Yeah. All right, moving on to the next question. We've got James, and he sent in an email. He said, been thinking, the MCU gobbles up lots of our attention and box office money. Let's say things never panned out and the MCU never got past Iron Man. What existing franchise would rise to the top and take that spotlight, Perry?
You know I'm really into Star Trek Discovery right now, so I'm picturing like that's our Terran landscape where everyone's mean and everybody hurts each other and it's all wrong. This is an interesting question because immediately when I read it, my mind went to, oh, well, if the MCU wasn't big, it would be the DCU or whatever they would decide to call it. But then I started to go back and I was looking at the landscape of films mm-hmm. and just what franchises were at the very beginning stages and might have popped a little more had the MCU not been taking up such a big portion of the box office pie at that time. And it made me think maybe Avatar, for example, mm-hmm. would have gotten off the ground a little quicker, because if Avatar was such a big presence, and it could have been one of the most epic franchises ever. I mean, there were a lot of other things with Avatar that have slowed down the process, and James Cameron isn't really one to rush, but I don't know. I think that Avatar might have caught on a little stronger, even as a fan franchise, but this is just all speculation. The other one that caught my eye was, speaking of Star Trek, was Star Trek, because that movie came out in 2009, and of course, Star Trek eventually had Star Wars to contend with, the new iteration of Star Wars, at least. But at that time, if folks that were going to the movies that are like us, I mean, I gravitate towards big franchises that I can get excited about. If I didn't have the MCU, I'm just trying to picture where my path might have taken me. And I wonder if it'd be Avatar. I wonder if it would be Star Trek. Maybe Warner Brothers would have shifted their plan with their DC properties. All hypothetical. It's interesting to think about.
Yeah, for me, I am going to have to go with the DC EU or whatever they want to call it, FU or whatever the hell they're calling it. Yeah, I would go with them simply because, you know, the movies I think would have been different. I think the rush to, because what happened with the MCU, which, you know, back when Iron Man came out, this was not a foregone conclusion. Mm-hmm. The whole idea of a shared universe was very, very, you know, kind of foreign to the studios. Mm-hmm. And had that not made it, I don't think DC would have pursued a shared universe as hard or as fast as they did, right? They rushed it. I mean, that's what happened. They had Man of Steel. And then they saw everything that was happening with Marvel, and they're like, oh, we got to get our own. And so they rushed Batman v Superman. I talked about this many years ago about how I thought Batman v Superman was a bad idea. It was a bad idea for that to be the follow-up to Man of Steel, because it was just too much. You want to establish your characters. You want to, someone like Batman is so iconic, like, and you want to start off after something like The Dark Knight, you want to, you know, establish who the new actor is. And so I feel like the DC universe would have taken Marvel's place, but it would have been a lot different. Probably less shared universe, because that wasn't a thing. And taking more time to develop their stories.
You know what that made me think of was a really sad possible reality had things panned out this way, is really Marvel is the one that kind of pushed forward the whole idea of cinematic universes. And then I started to think about how many failed cinematic universes we've had where they've tried to make a great cinematic universe before they made a great single movie. And it's just, you know, think of what The Mummy might have been like if they weren't chasing the cinematic universe dream. Think about how many good first movies we might have got had everyone not tried to follow Marvel's success, which really, their success is the way you should do it, with a good beginning movie like Iron Man, and then you build from there and you earn the right, you earn the ability to be able to stand on a particular foundation and then go off on any which direction, whereas everyone's just like, I want that end goal before I even take step one.
Yeah, you know, and there's other movie franchises that are like, well, once we get to number 7 in this franchise, like, let's start with the first one and see how that goes.
I know what that 6-7 jab is at. I'm not going to utter the words. Go Power Rangers. All right, next question. It comes from Kelso Williams from Facebook. Kelso writes, I've noticed a trend in which people are asking for and praising more three-dimensional villains, especially when it comes to the MCU. But some of the greatest villains of all time were not 3D, like Darth Vader and Hans Gruber. They were simply portrayed and directed in such a way that made them iconic. Do we have different standards for all our villains now, or are we just lacking in the creation of villainous icons? What's your take on this, Dennis?
Well, I think Kelso brings up a good point. We do have characters from the past that were villains that really didn't have much back history, and obviously we know a lot of Darth Vader's back history now, but in the first movie, really, he doesn't have much, right? But what he does have is an iconic look and presence to him. I think that's what it is with Hans Gruber and Darth Vader. They have a villainous presence that just kind of transcends even a character's history. And I think that's maybe what's lacking today, and that the only way you can kind of make up for it is actually to have like a deep three-dimensional character, you know, where before, like, I think that the looks and the presence were more important.
And the idea of falling back on a three-dimensional character sometimes cannot work in a villain's advantage too, because that's when you wind up with stupid things like bad backstories. I mean, even when you want to talk about Anakin, for better or worse, we wound up with his backstory, depending on how you feel about the prequels. I think that the information we got is super rich, and it makes me love that character even more. I wish it was, some of it at least, was done in a different way. But think about all the iconic horror slashers out there. How many horror franchises and horror villains have been ruined because someone had to explain away like a sad, sad childhood story that put them on the path of picking up a machete and wearing a mask? It doesn't always work, but I think the best answer to have a really solid, effective villain can, the answer to that could be so many different things. Because you know what? Sometimes it is backstory. Sometimes it's having that really strong motivation that led a character from point A to where we see them in the movie. Sometimes it's just a presence, like let's say a Darth Vader, where you could feel his presence fill up a room. You could feel that imposing presence. And then sometimes it's also heavily reliant on the hero and how the hero winds up reflecting the villain. But I think what it comes down to, or at least if I had to like rank all the things that I need most in villains, I think the top is motivation. And it doesn't even necessarily have to be like, you know, some really intricate, elaborate reason why like that person is going after that person in a movie. It could be something as simple as how it's used in The Strangers, for example, where those characters, when you see them, they're just used so effectively. When they're in the room, their presence doesn't necessarily fill up the room, but you feel them lurking everywhere. And it's that simple, really creepy idea that just gets in your head that they are three random people who are just doing this for fun. If you have those little things that can really get in someone's head, you could pull off just about anything.
Yeah, you mentioned horror, which, you know, I'm not obviously like a huge fan of, but think about the iconic looks of something like Jason or Freddy Krueger. Like even someone who, like myself, I know what they look like. They have iconic looks to them. So I think that's also maybe something that's missing from today, where we're not creating these visual looks to villains that like are unique or different.
That's kind of fair. Yeah. That's fair. I mean, I think probably two of the most recent horror villains that had really strong looks that I could think, actually, I could think of a more recent one, Babadook. Mm-hmm. Babadook is a villain that, one, had a great backstory, two, had a great connection to our heroine, and three, has this really easy to replicate look where how many Babadook memes are out there? So I guess you can check all those boxes in various ways.
Yeah, but I mean, even something like what he's talking about, like Alien. Alien is there's no backstory. I mean, there is, but I mean, when you watch the first Alien or the second
part of
Alien,
my problem with Prometheus, yeah, I guess.
But like, there's no, it's just scary looking. Mm-hmm. It's frightening. It's the presence of the alien itself versus like, we don't need the motivation for that alien is to just kill other people.
Yeah, so. I'm trying to think of other villains recently without so much backstory. I'm always thinking about Hans Landa from Inglourious Basterds, where just his circumstances and the position he finds himself in, and then just what, it's also actor, what Christoph Waltz brings to that role, how he makes that character different from, and really that's another thing that differentiates maybe a look, where a look could be similar. And you know, it's difficult to say, oh, like that alien, that xenomorph is creepier than this alien in this new movie, but when an actor fills a role with a certain presence, that could also be what you need to differentiate and make them stand out.
Yeah, for sure.
Alrighty, question number one, question number
four.
So you read it.
Yes.
I've messed this up last time too.
Anthony, through email, has written in, if you could enter the Oasis in Ready Player One, what pop culture inspires your avatar and vehicle? Thanks for having a look. My wife and I are big fans of the book. I'm a longtime Collider fan, but this is my first submission. Keep up the good work.
Okay, so probably a no-brainer. My vehicle might have to be a Jurassic Park Jeep. Mm-hmm. Mainly because, all right, because in the Oasis, it's like you want your greatest dreams. You want to live out your cosplay dreams. And more than anything, I want to get Jurassic Park decals and put them all over my Mini Cooper. But I can't justify doing it. I own the damn car. What if it left a mark on there? I can't do it. So I'm going to do it in the Oasis. I'm going to get a Jurassic Park Jeep. And then for my avatar, I didn't want to go super cliche and say, you know, I want a lightsaber or anything. But really, my mind goes immediately to what I would want to cosplay as if I was artsy and capable enough to actually do it well, and it would probably be a stormtrooper or have some sort of Mandalorian armor that is decorated to a T just my way.
Okay, for me, you know, watching the movie, thinking about all the 80s stuff and all my childhood memories, I'm actually killing two birds with one stone because my character is both. It's Optimus Prime. From Transformers. And I'm talking about the ones from the movies, I'm talking about the ones from the 80s cartoons, especially the 1985 movie, where I could, you know, my avatar would be Optimus Prime, and then I can transform into the truck and then and be the vehicle.
There's a lot of things. Yeah.
One of the vehicles I did really like in Ready Player One was Kaneda's bike from Akira in there. So I'm not choosing that because that's already been taken.
I would also have my own little Wally. And I would have a little Wally and a little Mo. So Mo would clean my hideout and then Wally would be my buddy. Yeah.
Okay.
Sidekick. You can have a sidekick in the Oasis. You could have whatever you want in the Oasis. You could live out all of your most amazing, craziest movie fantasies. And that is why I love that book. And now the movie.
All right.
One more question?
Yep.
Alrighty, this one comes from Joseph Ashley via email, who writes, "Hi Collider, do you think it's possible to create a mystery suspense thriller or film noir," I almost forgot about this question, "or film noir of characters of serial, like a detective or serial character who has to figure out, among other characters, who killed Cap'n Crunch?" So do you remember, this was the hottest costume back in the 90s in like middle school and stuff, and people would dress up as serial killers and have like the little like school size boxes of cereal with like knives and blood on it.
I do not remember that at all, but
it was a thing, okay. I swear.
So is that where this is coming from? Because like when I read this question, I was like, huh? It's an interesting one. I just don't know where it came from.
I don't quite know where. Oh no, I do know where it came from. Okay. It was while we were gone, something came up on a movie talk episode, and someone else sent in this great cartoon that he drew, and his name is escaping me. I'm gonna check it in a second. He drew a thing with Cap'n Crunch and Tony the Tiger, and I loved that. But if I was gonna get this is actually a really funny idea, like a weird, not shared cinematic universe, but a shared film with all the serial characters coming together. The ones that I would take out, actually, I like the B for Cheerios. Uh-huh. I always liked that one. The Lucky Charms one used to drive me nuts, so I'm gonna pluck him out. I don't like the Trix Bunny, so I'm gonna pluck him out too. Or they just die in the cold open. That's what they do. They die in the cold open.
All right. For me, like, instead of Captain Crunch, it would be Snap, Crackle, and Pop would die sequentially.
Okay.
And then the whole thing is like, why did they kill them off? Who did it? I'd have probably Toucan Sam would probably be the detective, and then the rest of the...
Toucan Sam was always cool.
And then the rest of the serials, characters as the suspects.
What was the frog?
Smacks.
Honey Smacks?
I think so,
That frog was always cool. The frog had like 90s vibes, right?
Yeah.
It could be a throwback noir, kind of. No, not really. Yeah. It doesn't really work that way.
There's Tony the Tiger. Who else is there? Count Chocula.
Count Chocula, yeah.
My favorite was, Not Fruit Loops was Toucan Sam. Fruity Pebbles. That was Flintstones, and they're already an existing character. They weren't really serial characters. They just created serial out of existing characters.
I think the most boring serial movie ever would be a Kix movie.
Kix.
Kix sucked. Who is Puffins? Peanut Butter Puffins.
Wasn't there like something that wasn't, was it something that was like Cheerios but worse or something like that? I can't remember. There was like something like Cheerios, worse.
It was probably like a healthy version of
Cheerios. Yeah, exactly.
Like I think regular Cheerios have no sweetener.
Yeah, but I think there was like an even blander version of Cheerios.
Cereal of choice right now.
It's still Fruity Pebbles.
Okay.
Like there's actually places, restaurants now that they will, I think in like Mama Fuko, where they do they take Fruity Pebbles, put it in milk, and they give you the
milk. Oh, the milk, yeah, cereal milk. That's a real thing. That's why I liked, what were the little, Cocoa Puffs.
Okay.
Cocoa Puffs. You would make the Cocoa Puffs and you would drink the milk. It's all about peanut butter puffins, guys. Peanut butter puffins. Just go get a box of those. So now we've covered our food, we've covered our movies. You know what else we still have to cover?
What's that?
Podcasts.
Yes, yes. We actually just launched our new Collider podcast network. You can right now, if you have been like a podcast subscriber, we've had one feed that has had all of them. You had Movie Talk, Jedi Council, Heroes, all of them in this one thing, and it's kind of getting, you know, a little full, a little complicated. And so we've actually created separate feeds. So if you're a subscriber, and then you know what's another great thing? Mailbag. Mailbag we never put on podcasts. Now we're putting it on there. So if you subscribe to the Movie Talk podcast, you will also get the Mailbag podcast. So there's that one, then there's Jedi Council, and then there's Heroes, and then we have the one that you, if you're already subscribed, it's called Collider Factory, and that actually has the Collider.com podcast, and we're actually going to be putting new shows on there that we are going to test out some stuff. We haven't decided, you know, what shows we may or may not bring back, so don't quote me on that, but like, for example, like a TV talk or a Nightmares, we might try that on a podcast for it.
Or Serial Talk. If you guys want Serial Talk, we'll give it to you.
And we put it in the Collider Factory feed, so stay subscribed to that one and just make sure to subscribe to the other ones. And then Christian Harloff is going to have his own podcast called One-on-One where he's going to interview... Actually, the first one came out yesterday, where he interviewed Dan Fogler, the comedian actor from Fantastic Beasts. And so he did like a 45-minute interview with him. And so he's going to start doing those. So check out our Collider Podcast Network. Just search for it. It's on iTunes. We're being presented by Podcast One. So if you download their app, we're on there as well. And so, yeah, I listen to podcasts. I don't have to listen to our podcast because I'm here listening to it live, right? But
you got to listen it to do it. You got to listen it to QC it. You got to listen to it when it goes up.
But I listen to podcasts, and it's great to put in while you're like working out or in your car driving.
Yeah, driving big time.
I'm you know, currently on a plane right now, probably listening to some sort of podcast. So
Wait. We need a recap from the week before. So I wound up binging Star Trek Discovery. I watched Veronica, the Netflix horror movie. Really, really good. What did you wind up watching?
I watched Daddy's Home 2. King Arthur, Mountain Between Us, is that?
The Mountain Between Us.
The Mountain Between Us, Gold, Matthew McConaughey's Gold.
Gold's all right.
Yeah, and then The Last Tycoon on Amazon.
Okay.
Oh, that's, you know, for some reason, like when I'm on, you know, I'm Stranger Things, I told you, I hadn't finished Stranger Things.
There were a
things,
lot
so.
Of people on our flight on the way there watching Daddy's Home 2. A lot of people. I'm that creep who likes to stand up and look at what everyone's watching.
Yes.
I can't help it. Thank you guys for watching this episode of Collider Mailbag. A lot of different stuff we're always going to cover from week to week. So as always, send in questions about the newsworthy stuff you want to hear more about. And also ask some behind the scenes questions. We want to have some fun. We want to keep it loose. We want to do some different things. So send all your questions to the Gmail account, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, everywhere. We will see them. Maybe we'll answer them on Saturday's show or Sunday's show. Dennis, thank you for being here as always. Safe travels. Thank you guys for watching. We will see you soon.
Hey everybody, Mark Ellis here. Thanks for watching this episode. You want to watch more? Then click up here. Or you can click right here for more great content from Collider. If you haven't subscribed to Collider Video, do so right now and share this vid with your friends. Thanks for watching.